I'm trying to create a complete singularity, but not through AI and not through actually becoming one with machine. For me, it might look like an orchestra. We might be using music as a vehicle, but in fact, what we're trying to achieve is the widening of the collective consciousness. My name is Kristjan Järvi, and I'm living the classical life.
Today we travel to the seaside resort city of Pärnu, located in Estonia on the Baltic Sea and popular in the region as a holiday destination with its many beaches, restaurants, and hotels. With its distinctive tree-lined streets and wooden architecture, the city was the summer home to violinist David Oistrakh, who gathered his musician friends to play together in his green dacha for ad hoc performances. As the younger son of Nemi Järvi, and brother of Paavo and Marika, conductor and composer Kristjan Järvi carves out a distinctly different musical path with his unique character and projects. I was thrilled to have this conversation with such an effusively warm human being with whom I found instant connection. We thank you, our viewers, for making this episode possible.
So what's your viewership?
That's the thing. It's online. We never really fully know. We have some analytics, but it's from all around the world, including from places that you wouldn't expect. You know, places in
like Bhutan.
Yes, yeah, actually, yes. And we had people from Saudi Arabia. We had Siberia. We had.
Well, Saudi's kind of you know, they're interested in everything now.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, basically people are generally, I think in the Middle East and Arabic countries, much more interested in things than actually, I mean, if you look at historically all of the civilization, maths and sciences and culture in any form, you know, actually originated from those areas, you know?
Yeah.
There's a more much more openness in giving and through that giving also receiving. And in the West, we're kind of very used to, before giving, we want to know what we get mm-hmm. for giving.
Like seeing the menu in advance.
Yeah, no, like, yeah, exactly. So before I give you anything, I want to see what I can get for it, you know?
Yeah.
And that actually is an impediment for us being open to more things.
So that's the thing. I want to start. I want to start exactly on that subject about not knowing what we're going to get. Let's talk about that concert last night. That was mind blowing. I had never experienced anything like that. I was going to call it a concert, but I don't know if that word even embodies everything we experienced there. I mean, it was. If I can outline just a few of the things that I witnessed, it was sort of primordial, it was primal, it was sensual, it was rhythmic, it was, we were immersed in colors, it was interactive, it was, for you, it was athletic. How do you try to describe an event like that to someone who doesn't know what they're going to get? I didn't even see the program mm-hmm. until afterwards.
I have always tried to kind of create situations where people are united. You know, united in a way which is outside of just kind of being united through a practical form, which is like, you know, a business deal or a, you know, kind of a, you know, financial setting or some kind of you know, like a vacation people go on or something, you know, but united. And not even a philosophy, through a field which encompasses everybody. And that field is actually kind of indescribable. It's creatable through nuances, through environments, through resonance, actually. I mean, I created this group called Absolute Ensemble in 1993, you know? And our first concert was a concert called Music for Change. and it was actually Music for Change in a philosophical sense, like let's do something different. But it was also kind of Music for Change because it was a benefit concert for homeless people. You know?
No kidding.
Yeah. And so everything has a double meaning and words have power. But we don't see words as a tool of resonance. We see them a tool of, you know, mindful understanding, you know? But I think that what makes mindful understanding so powerful is the fact that they are carried with a tone, you know? I mean, if I was to write something down, it would have a different effect on you, you know? And reading has a different effect than declamation and any type of resonance, you know? So when you play an instrument, you create a resonant field, right? Which you have to take people, which actually takes people into, you know, this vortex, so to say, you know? And these are all kind of quasi-metaphysical and at the same time, quantum physical aspects which actually overlap, you know? And you can describe this whole thing as bringing people together and creating environments so you can connect, you know, hemispheres, but this doesn't mean anything unless you actually are there, you know? Because to comprehend something with your mind that should be physically felt and intuitively kind of then carried on to others, you know, by the process of emulation, you know, of being part of that experience. This is kind of what I'm trying to create all my life, learning along the way, not just, you know, throwing up eye candy or, you know, just kind of like doing some kind of magic trick or, you know, being a circus or anything like that, but actually having this kind of life-changing experience. And basically what you're asking, what is this genre? You know, it's basically design experiences. And yesterday was a design concert experience. You know?
So I'm listening to you describe all of this. I'm thinking, whoa. So you've really had this kind of this vision of immersion, inclusivity. At what point did you start thinking along these lines? I mean, were you thinking about this as a kid?
Well, no. Look, I mean, I was a pianist, just like you, you know? And I hated that solitary life. I was just like, I was not having it, you know? I don't want to be in a practice room by myself, you know, for hours and hours and hours. And even if you're not in by yourself, you're then still by yourself because it's you and the piano, you know? And if you don't really kind of dedicate yourself to it, then... And if you don't love the process, right? Yeah. I mean, my piano teacher, she...
Nina Svetlanova,
who I absolutely, basically, if there's anybody I credit with me being a musician, it's her. It's actually only her, yeah. You know, because my parents didn't push, you know.
The idea that you would be a pianist at that point?
Well, my parents didn't push, and she actually cleverly kind of, after I had already submitted my applications to all other schools in different fields, you know, and not even musical. she said, you know, do this audition for Manhattan School of Music. You know, if you get in, the great. If you don't, fantastic also, you know, you can do whatever you want. And then I said, well, I guess it's not going to hurt, you know.
Yeah.
And so, but when after I got in, I realized that I couldn't say no to, you know, there was no going back because just then there was like, oh, come on, you know. And my interests were actually like astronomy, for one, you know. I really loved physics and astronomy. That was like, you know, where are we? What is this thing called, you know, existence, you know. Then I really love foreign relations. I thought maybe becoming a diplomat or something like this. Yeah.
Well, it's interesting that I hear you saying that, and I'm surprised, and yet I'm not surprised because I feel like all of those elements came out in the concert last night. I feel like it really did.
And you know, and then I thought, like, if I would be involved in music, then maybe I would be on the production side of music, you know, like producing hip hop or something, you know. I mean, like as first as a sound engineer, you know, and then, you know, going into you know, production. But yeah, because look, I mean, you know, when I went to Manhattan School of Music, I became friends with a certain group of people, composers, who were actually the coolest bunch of people there, you know, and they kind of took me in, you know. I was kind of like a loner pianist, kind of shy, you know, and so I became friends with this guy Gene Pritzker and Charles Coleman, and like they put all sorts of rap and God knows what into their compositions, and
so
I was like,
cool.
Wow, this is so cool, you know, that like, you know, back then, like, I think I was just like 5 years before that or 6 years, you know, it was early. Or mid '80s, you know, where you know, all this Run DMC and Aerosmith stuff, you know,
that's
Walk
great.
This Way and all this, you know, all that stuff was kind of was brand new, you know, and they were like, yeah, let's put that in. It's like, you know, and they were putting like, you know, it was like trio for oboe, you know, violin, cello, and rapper. And I was like, that's pretty hip, you know. That's
were you welcome cool. to it? Were
yeah,
you
yeah,
to
yeah.
It?
But and basically, then Gene, he said, look, I, you know, so I hear you're like from a family of conductors. You want to conduct some of my stuff? And I was like, I don't know anything about conducting. I'm a pianist, you know? So he's like, no, man, it's easy. Just like, so he actually made an ensemble for me. And then I conducted some of his pieces. And then from there, started this whole idea of like, hey, let's create a band together. And that's what we actually did. We called it Absolute Ensemble, and the rest is history.
Is that kind of how you got into conducting? I mean, yeah. So yeah. I wanted just to back up a little bit and just kind of find out what. Okay, so you come from the family of like mega famous musicians. Did when you were growing up, did you feel like, okay, great, now I have to be one too?
Well, actually, not that I have to be one, but I already decided that I wasn't going to be one.
Oh, really?
But you know, for me, this piano playing and this whole enthusiasm for music, which my father instilled in us, had to do with such like a genuine, non-kind of. It wasn't like music wasn't a form of achievement, you know. It wasn't like there to make you feel better, you know. It was there to actually be part of your life. It wasn't kind of even thought of as like a career thing. I mean, I never thought that my dad was kind of. And I don't think he ever thought that it was like a career thing. You know, it was like he just loved what he was doing, and he also got paid for it. You know?
Yeah.
You know, so it wasn't like a form of achievement, you know, but it became much more kind of a form of achievement when we moved to America, because then it was already like considered a career, as what's good for your career. And finally, I was like, that's not for me. This is like, there's too much like politics and nonsense here that I want to like do something else, you know. And so and then I decided completely against it, but then Nina Svetlana was like, no, you don't. It's like,
yeah.
And basically yeah. Basically I went to Manhattan School of Music, but I still had these aspirations for either doing like some kind of production work, or you know, becoming a diplomat, or you know, being a physicist or astronomer, or I don't know, you know. And then finally, through a very long and arduous kind of development of various bands and then own orchestras and festivals and all sorts of collabs with incredible musicians from like Joe Zawinul to you, like for example, we did the incredible town hall concert in just after 9/11 with a bunch of Arabian musicians, for example. It was very kind of taboo, you know, at that time in like 2002 or something like that, 2003, we did live Arabian Nights live at the New York City's town hall.
That's,
you know,
awesome.
And just at that time when everybody was like so like phobic, you know, to anything Arab or right. Middle Eastern or, you know, anything Muslim, you know, it's like, and we were like, why? I mean, this like the direction is completely, it's like, it's our attention is directed to not toward non-thinkers, you know, you know? And it's kind of like, oh, it's easy to hate somebody. Okay, let's hate somebody. No, but it's like, so basically we had all these projects, but at the same time, then I decided that I'm going to become a so-called serious conductor, you know? you know, I had a great orchestra in Sweden, for example. That was my first, well, after my very, very first job, which was assistant to Esa-Pekka Salonen in Los Angeles, Phil, I went to Sweden and I had like a fantastic opportunity to do all sorts of great things with it was kind of a smaller orchestra. It was Norrlands Operan. It was like, you know, Nordic opera house in a city called Umeå. And I really loved those guys because they were basically open to anything. So I thought like, wait a second, orchestra is like, can be cool, you know? And I didn't know that like institutions could be so, so hip to new things, you know? And then I took that same spirit of Absolute Ensemble to that orchestra, you know? And we created all sorts of festivals, recordings. We did this SACD, you know, surround audio.
I actually have a few of those, yeah.
You know? And so then after that, I went to Vienna, to Tonkonsler Orchestra. And with that same spirit, We did amazing things there. I mean, this tone concert orchestra, which was actually like a very second class orchestra, kind of a provincial orchestra. Yeah. It actually threw all sorts of struggles. They resulted in such things as Bernstein's Mass, which I think is, for me, one of the most amazing pieces actually that's ever written. Hmm. But it has that kind of, just, it's got everything except, and the kitchen sink in there, you know? All sorts of folk bands, singers, street choirs, soloists, you know, orchestra, and that. It's like a Mahler 8 deconstructed, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so basically, we even did a Steve Reich recording, which actually made him love his own piece, three movements, so much so that it wasn't only used in Hunger Games, for example, but it was also the reason why he actually created a new, completely new orchestral composition, which was then already, we were one of the commissioners with Baltic Sea Philharmonic, among Sydney Symphony, London Symphony Orchestra, New York Philharmonic, I mean, a bunch of orchestras, you know, who actually commissioned this music for ensemble and orchestra, you know. And so he said orchestral music is just a bad orchestration, it's not possible, but, you know, orchestras can't play my music. And finally, after that recording that we did of the Steve Reich's three movements, he actually was like, oh my God, maybe really it's like generation has changed, maybe young people really now can play my music. And he was just so enthused, you know. And I mean, he's one of my favorite, just absolutely heroes. And there's two heroes for me. There's Joe Zawinul, who is the creator of Weather Report. I don't know if you know this band, fusion band.
Yeah.
But he's like my musical father, I would say, you know. I mean, other than my real father, Neme, you know, but because what he taught me there in terms of playing in time, phrasing, just style, taste, improvisation. I mean, when we did his last studio recording, which is called Absolute Zawinul, Absolute thought we were like, we knew everything, you know. It's like, you know, then we did the first rehearsal with him, and then we walked out like, sorry that we're here, you know. You know? and from there, oh my God, really, a world opened up to me that I didn't even know existed, you know.
Yeah.
And so basically, trial and error, being open to different things, it just like gave me such a fantastic kind of playground to actually discover myself, of course, through making a lot of mistakes, you know. Mm. And I had these MDR, Kristjan Järvi festivals, saying like, you know, like going north, going south, going east, going west. And then we did like the elements and all sorts of northern lights and ice festival. And I don't know, it was just like a bunch of stuff. But all of these things actually have a certain institutional limit, parameters, you know? And in 2008, this guy Thomas Hummel came to me, and he said, "Hey, why don't we, you know, are you interested in creating a youth orchestra that surrounds the Baltic Sea?" You know, and I was like, "Well, yeah, sure, why not?" And I was like, I didn't give it much thought, in fact. And so we did a concert in Riga, and an Usedom festival. So taking that same spirit, you know, which I'm constantly like talking about, which basically is the absolute ensemble spirit, which actually was now in Sweden and then in Vienna and then in Leipzig and other, you know, and there I kind of did the same things. And when we reached that ceiling, you know, where it kind of plateaued out, where every orchestra situation kind of plateaus out, you know, that you can't actually go beyond the institutional limits, we decided with Baltic Sea Philharmonic that, okay, we're not actually youth orchestra anymore, We're doing like really, really, well, first of all, we all got much older, you know, by that time that we changed our name, I was like 42, I think, you know, and then we instituted just new, much more kind of elaborate performance environments. So including lighting and all sorts of projections and bringing in a lot of tech, you know. And then the musicians were like, how are we gonna do this stuff, you know? And I said, well, I mean, I'm not gonna get rid of the production aspects, and I don't want you guys to be uncomfortable. So instead of actually kind of dumbing it down in terms of production, I said, why don't we just start memorizing stuff?
I was just going to ask. The concert last night was 2 hours of incredible music, and I was, you know, eventually it dawned on me, everyone was playing from memory. And if we're talking about inclusivity, I felt like this made me, as the audience member, feel much more, much closer to the players. And this is an interesting theme because I hear a lot of young people these days feeling, you know, they're using the word elitism a lot.
Look, I mean, elitism, I mean, we've come a long way from elitism, you know. I'm a little bit famous in New York for, you know, when Time Out New York came out, it was like one of the first editions. You know?
Yeah.
I had a big interview on there, you know, and I famously declaimed that the Boulez era is over.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah, you did that.
And a lot of people hated me for it and kind of relegated me to, I don't know where, but in any case, that was elitism. For me, that was elitism, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. So from there, we've come a long way, you know? And I think I have to say that right now what's happening in music is a lot more inclusive, but what's happening in the world is a lot more inclusive in general, because look, our understanding of collective consciousness is different. We're still quite egoistic, but less so than we have been in the past. We're less fearful and more open to things than we have been. I mean, generally speaking. I mean, of course, we're very focused on details, you know? And actually, if you realize that you don't have to be so uptight, you know? And you don't have to be so, like, on edge all the time, and you don't have to do the right thing, and you don't have to, there's a certain way to act. There's actually, just be yourself, be cool, relax, and then you're gonna actually tap into the magic that's around us.
Are you surprised by the reactions of the audience? I've never seen an audience, I mean, I felt like I was in a rock concert at some point. Everyone was feeling the magic. I was seeing the lights, I was hearing this music, which included, for the people who weren't there, included your compositions. I felt like everything that we were feeling was in some way connected to, for example, astronomy, some of the images that we've been seeing from the Webb telescope.
Yes.
I felt like it was in it. There was some larger message. I don't think it's a stretch for me to say that was in there. The audience was feeling included in something that was elevated,
yeah.
Not elite.
Well, think about it. I mean, just think about our existence, right? It doesn't make a difference whether we know or we don't. And actually, there's limitations where the mind can go, you know? But there's actually limitlessness where the heart can go. You know, the brain is basically saying, hey, I have to make sense of everything. I have to make schemes, and I have to make plans, and I have to live here in order to plan tomorrow, in order to achieve something that actually doesn't matter, but okay, I need to do it anyway because it's gonna make me feel good. I can, you know, massage my ego, and I can make sure that everybody thinks that I'm really, really good at what I do, and therefore it gives me life, it gives life's purpose, you know? But then the heart says, actually, don't do that, because everything you're actually doing is giving me a huge overload, and from there I can't operate properly, and that's therefore where all diseases come. And you know, you're actually kind of giving me so much strain, And so right now the battle is actually the heart's trying to doing something and the mind suppressing it. These battles need to be fought. You know, these battles within ourselves need to be kind of clarified, you know? And once the majority, I would say, or a larger majority, you know, start to actually realize that, wait a second, this moment here and now is an incredible space for my being, you know? That when I'm talking to you, I'm really talking to you, you know? I love this situation. I'm fully invested in it. Just like the musicians, they're fully invested in that moment, you know, on stage. Not any other moment. They're not thinking about how much they're getting paid or what they're gonna do afterwards. They're in that particular moment. And they're even more so in the moment because they're not actually primarily involved with the sensation of reading, but they're already telepathically connected. Everybody has to help each other, you know? They're cueing each other. They are actually communicating with each other on a completely different plane, you know? Because it's one collective brain, what you see there. It's not actually me who's giving cues and being really, you know, analytical about this thing. In fact, the hardest part of this whole process is trying to remember what you've learned, and then forgetting the text that you've learned, and then already having the trust in everybody else to be able to build on the text that you've learned, so you can make it seem like not don't you only know the form, not don't you only know the harmonies, the notes, the various aesthetic ways of playing, but you can add to that. You know, so basically I see this as constant construction work. And if we see things in those parameters, life is just like incredibly magnificent.
So I'm curious to ask about your relationship to how much we can achieve in our lifetime. So we're talking about, what I'm trying to get at here is you were jumping around the stage yesterday with the athleticism of a teenager or a 20-year-old. We're celebrating some birthdays this year. Your father, 85, your brother, 60, and you, 50. Do you feel like you're 50?
Well, that's the thing, is that my mind doesn't allow me to feel old. You know, and that's actually where you start feeling old first, is actually if your mind starts to feel old. So if my father, I mean, I honestly cannot believe that he's 85 years old right now, because he's, first of all, he's in very good shape, but second of all, he's he wants to live, you know, he wants to actually do the stuff that, you know, everybody who actually loves going out and being part of things and, you know, imparting knowledge or actually learning or whatever, you know, it's like he wants to do all of that stuff. He's not like, oh, can I stay home and sleep, you know? So and that's the thing, is that if he did, then he'd probably not be around anymore, you know? Yeah. And of course, my mom is just like, and she's actually the super trooper, you know? I mean, she's just the reason why kind of, you know, he's in such good shape. She keeps him in line very much. You know, there's, we are all kind of, I would say, like three, it's these kind of rascals, you know, who you know, one is Tom Sawyer, the other one is Huckleberry Finn, you know, and then you have, you know, the Mark Twain himself, which is my dad, you know. You know, I don't know. I think I'm more like Huckleberry Finn, and Pablo's like Tom Sawyer, you know. But the thing is, because these characters in life, all of them, which I'm describing, they manifest in different ways. But in fact, I mean, why we love these books and why do we love Shakespearean characters? Because actually, it's all of us, you know. That Shakespeare is actually not, he's personifying everybody and nobody at the same time, you know? So we can relate to all of these characters so much, and we're actually addressing all the same issues, you know? And it's very interesting just in our family, you know, my sister also, I haven't mentioned her, but she's also a conductor, you know?
Yeah.
If you believe it or not, she has a flute orchestra.
A flute orchestra.
the sound that it creates, I mean, there's just actually a magical sound. You know, the force fields that it creates is just something that actually could have suited last night's concert extremely well. So all of us in our own ways are kind of trying to solve this heart-mind balance issue and trying to achieve the yin and yang that can create this unanimity. You know, everybody who's like a Zen kind of guru tries to meditate themselves and practices meditation to a point where they can achieve singularity with themselves and the world around them. Actually, to the point of just where you're as small as a tip of a pinhead, you know? Just, and everything is in there, the whole entire universe, you know, and yourself. And that's actually a very good imagery of what I'm trying to create. I'm trying to create a complete singularity, but not through AI and not through actually becoming one with machine. For me, it might look like an orchestra. We might be using music as a vehicle, but in fact, what we're trying to achieve is the widening of the collective consciousness.
Kristjan, thank you so much for being here on the show. It was an amazing, amazing conversation for me. I'm mesmerized by everything you do. Thanks for this
incredible...
Thank you.
It's very nice to be here, and you're awesome. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I wish I could have spoken for 5 more years with this guy.